is the Holy Spirit plain. We have a burning desire to lift up Jesus' name.
Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Faith and Victory Church just went live. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So it should show up in your feed relatively soon that we've gone live. I'm hoping it'll show up real soon. And so you can share it. But tell everybody to join us. Hallelujah. Here at Faith and Victory Church on our Faith and Victory Church Facebook page. Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Amen. As Medea would say, amen. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen, amen, amen. All right. Well, we're glad to have you tonight. We're continuing our ministry and teaching on the new birth and new creation realities. And we're going to kind of pick up where we left off last time. We got to that man's, you know, spirit, soul, and body. 1 Thessalonians 5:23, we get that. He is the pneuma, psuche, and soma. And there was an effect in the fall of man that took place because of the fall of man. And it was that his spirit died. And we talked about this. We're not going to recover the ground in depth. But death in the Bible does not mean cessation of existence. It means separation. Physical death is the separation of the human spirit from the physical body. Spiritual death is a separation of the spirit from the body. Physical death, that's physical death. Spiritual death is separation of man's spirit from God. And so, we're live. Share it, folks. Hallelujah. Send it out there and let people know. Join us. Amen. I'm going to type in here real quick. Join us. Praise be to Jesus. We want you. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. And I just sent that out there. And so all my friends just got told to join us. Hallelujah. All right. So man died spiritually. His body died, and then his soul went through a progressive denigration or deterioration. So, remember we talked about in Genesis where it says, in the day that you eat the fruit thereof, thou shalt surely die. That the Hebrew says, in dying, thou shalt die. In other words, his spirit died instantly. Eventually, the body died. But in that process, in between that, the mind went through progressive denigration, or we could say death, in the sense that it became separated from God's wisdom and God's light and God's understanding. Okay? And so man's mind became depraved over time. We see right out, almost out of the gate, we see Cain killing Abel. Well, that's depravity. You know, all because he wasn't happy with the fact that God didn't like his sacrifice. Are you here? You're gone home. And all Cain had to do was go barter with Abel for an animal, and because it required the shedding of blood to cover the sin. The first fruits of your garden didn't cover it. Corn oil didn't cover your sin. Okay? And so we have in man the effects of the fall. There is an instant spiritual death, a progressive soulish death, and an eventual body or physical death. Okay? Those are the three things that took place. And so, God created man. He created him in his likeness and his kind. We've been through all that. Pick up the last few weeks. Some of them aren't out there because we had a problem with our camera and we got to redo them. Our video, our live feed's out there, so you can pick them up from there, but off of our website, they're not out there. All right. So, we have man in this fallen state. Now, we've covered the question. Remember the question, did God create man in a fallen state? The answer is no. We talked about how he was created in his likeness and in his image and his kind in the same class of being as God himself. We've covered that. And so man was formed from the dust of the ground. God breathed in him the breath of life. The body was the spirit, was the residence of the real person, which is a spirit which was intact with the soul in a physical body. The soul was the intellect and soulish and the seat of the will, the seat of emotions. And then the body was the house of the spirit. And the pneuma was the place that God dwells. God doesn't dwell in your body. He dwells in your spirit. He comes into your spirit. Amen? Man was created to have dominion. Man was created to have fellowship with God. Man's spiritual death. God commanded man not to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Was it an apple? I have no idea.
I vote for a pear.
The Bible tells us it was the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Didn't tell us if it was an apple, an orange, a tangerine, a clementine, a cutie, I mean, whatever else, you know, or a banana. It didn't tell us. Now, or a pear. Now, my guess is it was none of those. My guess is that whatever that fruit was on that tree was only on that tree and none other. Okay? So that would be my take. That, you know, that's purely opinion. I had no Bible for it, but you don't have any Bible against it. Okay? We do know it was called a fruit. We don't know that it was called an apple, buffed up by Eve and deceiving Adam over there on the back side of the garden while he was fishing. Dear Lord, women did it again. Now, I am joking. Don't you go film a Nazi on me. Okay? No, he was right there the whole time the thing took place. The Bible says she did turn and give to her husband. He did eat. He was with her. With her. With her. He was there. All right? So man died spiritually, which means he became separated from God. Because of that separation from God, the wisdom and the counsel and the light went out. And because the wisdom and the counsel and the light went out, his mind began to degradate. In how it processed, how it thought, it became flesh-ruled. The flesh dominated. The soul was now governed by the physical senses instead of out of communion with God. Okay? The soul became governed by the senses. And the body became carnal. Death doomed. And the spirit was left empty. Now when I say empty, void of God. All right? Spirit now is left empty, void of God. The soul now governed by the senses. The body is now carnal or death doomed. I look at that and go, my Lord, if somebody's trying to read that, they're really in trouble. Mm-hmm. There we go. Is that better? Hallelujah. And so the body, so we have now the three aspects of man are now under the domain of spiritual death, the effects of spiritual death. And who is their master? Satan is man's master. Or, as Jesus said, where in John 8:32, he's their father. Your dad is the devil. 8:44, you're right, Penny. You are right. Thank you. It is John 8:4. I thought that when I was putting that there, I was going to come back over here and check, but Penny beat me to it. Jesus said, your dad is the devil. No, my papa ain't no Rolling Stone. Some of y'all seen, okay, if y'all haven't seen Madea movies, you need to watch at least Meet the Browns or something like that. That's I laughed so hard I couldn't hardly breathe. All right. Have you seen Meet the Browns? Yes. Val, was it funny? Mm-hmm. My family told me, you got to see, well, actually, Deneen told me, you got to see that movie, Pastor. All right, so I rented it. I'm upstairs in my bedroom watching it, and the kids hear something hit the floor downstairs. I had rolled out of the bed. I was laughing so hard, just sleeping on my knees, beating the bed. I couldn't even breathe. I just laughed and laughed and laughed. Hallelujah. Yeah. It was that whole scene where he said, your daddy is a pimp. Anyway. That's your daddy. Satan's your, he will pimp you out to the defeat. He'll pimp you out to sin. He'll pimp you out to struggle. He'll pimp you out to poverty. I mean, he's not a good daddy. But he is man's father. And these are the things that are taking place. Man's heart's left void of God. Man's now governed by the senses. He's carnal. He's death doomed. His will now is tied to his senses and not to a relationship with God. Okay? So, remember what's our whole premise in all this? Jesus came and told Nicodemus, John, probably the most famous scripture in all of Christendom, John 3:16, Well, that whole passage, I'm sorry, that whole passage, John 3, 1 through 16, where, you know, Nicodemus says, you know, comes to him by night and says, Master, we know that a man come from God, for no man can do the things you do except God be with him. And Jesus said, except the man be born again, he shall not see the kingdom of heaven. Okay? Now, man is born, as we said, in the likeness image of God. He's now fallen. Now his spirit is void of God. God's not in his spirit. People go around, well, we're all God's children. Uh-uh. Satan's your daddy. If you're not born again, Satan is your daddy. Now, God created humanity, created Adam and Eve to procreate, but after the fall, Satan becomes master, and Jesus said, in order to remedy this situation, you must be born again. Because the effects of spiritual death have left him void of God in his spirit. His soul is now, as the New Testament says this, it says that the wisdom of this world is first earthly, sensual, and devilish. So now the unregenerated man, his mind is governed by an earthly, sensual, and devilish mindset. That's why we say stupid things like killing the baby in the womb is a woman's right to choose. That is an earthly, sensual, and devilish mindset.
Yes.
Women can do whatever they want to do with their bodies. Well, yeah, you sure can. And we don't want to get into that much further, but you could have done something before you got pregnant.
That's right.
Hello. The word no works real good.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that went over big. You're misogynic. Oh, just take your stupid words and go fly a kite with them.
Amen.
You hate women. No, I believe in life.
Hallelujah.
I believe in life.
Yes.
It is an earthly, sensual, and devilish mind that wants to kill the unborn.
Yeah.
And that same crowd most of the time runs out to the prisons when they're going to execute a mass murderer, rapist, throat slasher, and demand that he get to live because he's a human.
Mm-hmm.
But not in your neighborhood. So now we have the spirit of man is void of God. Now God, remember, God created man in his image, in his likeness, and after his kind, which meant the life of God was in him. God's nature, God's essence was in that body. But when he fell, he became void of God. Now remember, does anybody know the three themes of 1 John? Anybody know right off the first, the themes of 1 John? The whole epistle. These are the three themes. Number one, let me say it this way. God is one. Light. Two. Love. Three. Life. These are the themes of 1 John. God is light, life, and love. And when the man became void of God, his spirit became darkened, the glory went out, and he knew he was naked. God created man to be a light being like him. Hello? We get glimpses of it. And the biggest glimpse is the Mount of Transfiguration. When Jesus stood on the mount and was transfigured before them, and his countenance became as the noonday sun, and his raiment changed. Because if it were just a second, just a moment, he let the light out. Now that's how Adam and Eve were in the garden. They were clothed in that. See, this is why we need to understand spiritual things over carnal things. Because when the kingdom of darkness sees you, they see a Jesus walking around.
Amen.
All right.
Oh, you're going to blasphemy now. No, wait a second now. We were born of him. I'm born again. Hallelujah. The life of God has now entered into me again. And what's coming? Now we know this. The love of God has been shed abroad in the heart by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
We're born of the life of God. We have once again become light beings. I'm going to tell you something. Hell had a hissy fit when the church got birthed. Because they saw, they're in the spiritual realm, and they're seeing in the spiritual realm. And they're seeing all these people getting born again, and all of a sudden they're leaving the kingdom of darkness and transformed into the or translated to the kingdom of God's dear Son, which is the kingdom of light. And all these spirits are coming alive unto God again. What's happened? They're no longer void or empty of God. God's re-entered them. Hallelujah. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man open the door, and I and my Father will come in and make our abode with him. The light's come back. I said the light came back. So in the spirit realm, you look like Jesus. You're not Jesus. You're in the body of Christ. But you're born of him. Your spirit is no longer void of God. The light's no longer out. It's now rekindled. It's now been born again. God's life is in you. So you got to understand, when you show up, the devil knows he's in a heap of trouble. So how, I'm jumping so far ahead of myself, I got to come back and cover some ground. How does he get to find out who you are or who you aren't? See, we have to renew our mind to the Word of God so we have the revelation of who we are in Christ. So we talk like the Word talks. We say like the Word says. We do like it does. And then Satan doesn't know if it's Jesus talking or you talking, because you're speaking from the position of light with God's life in you. You have not become God himself. You're born of God. You're in the body of Christ. See, I don't want anybody to misconstrue what I'm saying. I have not become God. But I'm born of God. I'm an heir of God. I'm a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And this has re-entered my being. Hello? So they're looking out there in the spirit realm, and they see all these people born again running around looking like Jesus. And so how does Satan, he comes to try to figure out, who's that guy over there? Is that Jeff or is that Jesus? Prod, prod, prod. Negative confession comes out. That's one of them confession that the believers don't know what they're talking about. Get him. Because all Jesus is going to tell them is written. Amen? Hallelujah. So, let's backtrack since I jumped, 14 pages of notes ahead. Because these are the effects of the fall. So, I went and filled up over here by it, so, I don't know how I'm going to fix that. Okay. All right. Spirit, soul, body. I guess I better write them out. That is connected to that bracket here. Jesus said, remember Jesus said what? We must be born again. He's talking about a spiritual birth. Makes it very clear in John 3. He's talking about a spiritual birth. What gets born again? Because Nicodemus said, can you go back into your mother's womb and be born the second time? Soma, body. Uh-uh. Why? Because this thing didn't start with the body. It started with the pneuma. It started with the spirit. So if you're going to fix it, you don't start with the result of it. You start with what caused it. So in order for man to get back into place, he had to have a second birth. But Nicodemus thinking it's body. And Jesus is like, man, come on. Come on, Nick. Are you a teacher of Israel? I know not these things. I don't understand these things. It's not your soul. It's not just changing your mind and committing to become a Christian or a convert to Christianity. We don't get converted. What do you mean? We don't adopt the teachings of Christ. We don't adopt Christian practices, and that makes us a Christian. Jesus said, and said it extremely clear, you must. Boy, must be born again. I'm going to put B.A. That does not stand for Bachelor of Arts. That means born again. Okay? You must be born again. Like Shambot says, he said, I got my B.A. and my B.H.T. I got my born again and my baptized in the Holy Ghost. Brother Shambot, go ahead on. Jesus said you must be born again. Adam's failure, his spirit died immediately, instantly. The light went out. Over time, his soul became denigrated, and eventually his body died. And Jesus makes it clear that the second birth is a spiritual. It's a spiritual birth. I'm not using different colors because they can't pick it up on television. If I use the red or the green, they can't even see it. It just doesn't show up. So for those who are watching, if you watch on a big screen, you can see what I'm writing. Okay? So, let's look at 2 Peter chapter 1, because the first thing, you know, let's look at Romans 8:16. I'm sorry, let's go to Romans 8:16. Y'all learning anything?
Yes.
Good. So you got to go teach others.
Amen.
You got to go make disciples. You got to get people born again, teaching the word. Hallelujah. So what happens when you're born again? Well, let's first of all look at Romans chapter 10, because we're going back up to Romans 8. Romans chapter 10. So Jesus said you must be born again. Let's go to Romans 10, 8 through 10. Okay? All right, Romans 10, 8 through 10. What saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart, that is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, or confess, one translation says it this way, Jesus is Lord. In other words, you declare his lordship over your life. You submit to his lordship. And what? Believe. In the heart. I'm just going to leave out some different words in there. Okay, so if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and shall believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, raised. They got to believe that Jesus has been raised from the dead. He's not a figure. He has been raised up. Hallelujah. Thou shalt be saved. Now again, saved is sozo. All-inclusive word of salvation, okay? Thou shalt be saved. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth in him should not perish. I'm sorry. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness. The heart man believeth. And with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Salvation is the word soterios, which is the noun. It is the noun for sozo. This is the verb. This is the noun. Okay? They're in the same word group. They're in the sozo word group. Okay? So you have sozo and soterios. I believe I spelled that right. I think the U might be, that U may not be in there. I think it's soterios. I think it's this way, but I could be wrong. Okay? Like I said, I'm not a Greek scholar. I don't have, you know, all that. But, you know, so Jesus, it says, confession is made into salvation. Soterios. Salvation. The verb noun comparable to the verb sozo. And so what happens here? How do you get born again? Remember? Now, confessing all your sins don't get you, and God will take the heart of what you're doing, but biblically, you confess his lordship and believe in your heart that he's been raised from the dead, that saves you. Peter preached on the day of Pentecost without the revelation. He preached what he had at the time. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. After declaring he had been raised up. The story Dad Hagen tells about the Indian The old out on the Navajo reservation with big old Indian, and he got drunk all the time. And he just go into church and tear stuff up and go all over town. Took four or five police cars to come get him and hold him down. He was a rascal. Came into a church service one day, was sitting in the back row, had a missionary in there, and she's preaching, whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. At the end of the service, she gives an altar call. This guy gets up, no tears, no emotion, walks down to the altar and goes, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Gets up and goes back to his seat. And they're going, no. You're not saved. He said, why not? Said, you got to do more than that. What have I got to do? But you got to do more than that. He said, didn't she just say that if you call on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved? I called on him 3 times. Hallelujah. Amen. And it came one of the best Christians in the place. First, they thought he was going to come tear up the pulpit. Hallelujah. Are you here? Going home. And so we have here, man must be born again. So what's born again? Remember from John 3, we find out that Jesus has said you must be born of the Spirit and of the flesh. We've already been born of the flesh. If you're here, you're born of the flesh. So the second birth, the new birth, the born again thing you need, Jesus makes it very clear in John 3, it's spirit. Okay? Your spirit must be born again. It has to go from an entity void of God back to having the light once again. Amen? And so we have here, when man's born again, let's look at 2 Peter chapter 1. We'll read 2 or 3 verses here. Colossians 1:13 says, we've been translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad you're translated into the kingdom of his dear Son? Amen. All right. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 4. Says, whereby I give unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature. Partakers? Of the divine nature. We get to partake of the divine nature. How? Through the new birth. When you're born again, the life. Remember, God's light, God is life. God is life. Your spirit is born again, and now it is no longer void, but it is full of God. The void has been removed. The life, see, the void has been removed through the new birth. Praise the Lord. So we were partakers of the divine nature. 1 Corinthians 6:17. This is taking a lot longer because it's... How many believe God with us we get a new building again and get our own place we can just come in and go? Okay? Listen to 1 Corinthians 6. So 1 Corinthians, we're still on here. 1 Corinthians 6. 17. What's that say? It says here in 1 Corinthians 6:17, that he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Oh. We've now been joined back to God. Our spirits are no longer void, are no longer alienated, are no longer separated. We're no longer what? Spiritually dead. We have been made alive unto God through Jesus Christ, through the new birth, and now we're full of God. His life now has taken over. That void, empty, dead, separated spirit, that the life of God has entered in. He's born again, and now his very essence once again abides in your spirit. And you become a light being, and his love has been shed abroad in your heart by the Holy Ghost. Come on, get charismatic, say Shunda. Amen. All right. And so now he's one spirit with God. And what does 2 Corinthians say? Okay, we'll just take that over here. 2 Corinthians 5. 17 through 21. 2 Corinthians 5. That is a 2. That's a second. See if we can't separate that a little bit. 2 Corinthians 5, 17 through 21. Flip over there. It says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, what is he? He's a new creature. Some translations, one translation says new creation. Another says a new species. That's post-new birth. Your body didn't change. If you were overweight, you were overweight when you left the altar or left wherever you gave your heart to Jesus, whether you were in the car, the house, the bathroom, I mean, in the shower, if you were, you know, whatever. You still were the same person physically. So it was not a soma event. It didn't happen to your soma. We have, according to Ephesians, the seal, the promise of the future redemption of our bodies. You're going to get a new body. You can keep it healed. You can keep it well. You can keep it whole here. But your body is still a carnal body. We know from the Word of God that when Christ returns, this mortal shall put on immortality, and this corruption shall put on incorruption, and will be changed in the moment in the twinkling of an eye. So the body didn't get transformed. Now we can keep it in health and wholeness, but it's eventually going to die if Jesus doesn't come back. It's going to wear out. So we know that from just the analyzation of people being born again, that it was not a suke or a soma birth. And the one reason we can say that is because 2 Corinthians says, old things passed away, and behold, all things became new. Well, the only part of the being that now can be left to be in reference to is the pneuma. The spirit of man. The spirit of man. Jesus made it clear in John 3 that the birth he was referring to was a spiritual rebirth. Not a physical, not a body. Wasn't just changing your mind. It was a complete transformation of the human spirit. Why? Because the human spirit had become aligned with Satan. John 8:44, Satan had become his master, his father, his spiritual father. Man's spirit is aligned with him, and the way to get out of his kingdom is the same way man went into his kingdom. Adam was born from life unto death, and Satan became his spiritual father. Now, the way God was going to get him out was he'd be born again from death unto life. And the spirit of man was to be born again. Hallelujah. And so we have here Jesus saying that you must be born again. We have Romans telling us that if you'll confess that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart God raised him from the dead, you'll be sozo, saved. That's how we get into salvation. Soterius. And now we have the fact that man gets born again. Now remember, when man died in the Garden of Eden, his spirit died instantly. It was an instant transformation from life unto death, because they ate the fruit and then they knew they were naked. The light. First Corinthians, First John, remember, for the light went out. And then over time, the mind, the soul, mind, the will, the intellect, the emotions, progressively denigrated to the point it's earthly, sensual, devilish. And then, ultimately, the body dies. When you get born again, it is a process in reverse. What I mean is, it reverses the same way it happened. The spirit gets born again. The life of God comes into it. The soul, the psuche, gets renewed or regenerated through feeding on the Word of God. Receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save, sozo, your soke, not your spirit. When James writes in James 1, 21 and 22 about receiving the word of God, and it will save your soul. It will sozo your suke. He is not referring to getting born again. Because if you read the beginning of his letter, he's talking to the church. Okay? He will sozo your suke, make sound, restore. Remember the psalmist says, he restoreth my soul. Jesus said the spirit had to be born again. Your spirit doesn't get restored, it gets born again. There's a difference. I said there's a difference. But through the feeding on the word of God and the renewing of the mind, Romans 12, verses 1 and 2, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed. Had a metamorphosis, a metamorpho. That's where we get our Greek, our English word metamorphosis from. Okay? Be transformed. Transform comes from metamorpho in the Greek. Metamorphosis. To what? By the renewing of your mind. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Transform, metamorpho. Transform from what? The earthly, sensual, devilish mind to the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Can you say glory? Hallelujah. And so, man gets born again. He's full of the life of God. He's one spirit with the Lord. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, and I didn't finish reading all that, hallelujah, he's a new creature, a new creation. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things became new. And then the next verse starts out and says, and all things are of God. Verse 18. Who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. To wit, or that's King Jimmy for to know, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now, let me say something here. You can't take that verse and run out here and start saying universalism. God doesn't hold anybody's penalty against them. He was reconciling the world to himself, not imputing the trespasses. God's not holding it against him in Christ. But let me tell you something. You die without Christ? Too much scripture to back that up. Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God did beseech you by us. We pray you in Christ said, be reconciled to God. Verse 21. For he hath made him sin who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And so now we have, because the Spirit is now alive unto God, it's one Spirit, we're full of God, we're a new creature. What's happening? The Spirit's no longer void, it's full of God, it's made one with God. The light's re-entered. What did the psalmist say? The spirit of man is the candle of the Lord, searching all the inward parts of the belly. Now, we can commune with the Father of spirits, spirit to spirit, and revelation and light come, that as we break the word of God, the Spirit of God can speak to us and through it into our hearts. And bring revelation, which will bring in here Romans 12, 1 and 2, James 1. Hallelujah. Glory to God. James 1, 21. What? Romans 12, be transformed, had a metamorphosis. James 1, 21, receive a meekness, the engrafted word, able to save your soul. Now we begin the progressive restoration of the suke. See, your spirit gets born again. We're a new creature. The life of God's in us. The light's come. His love is in our heart. By this shall all men know your disciples, that you're my disciples, because you have love one for another. So the very three things that John's theme is in 1 John is now what we have in us. The light, the life, and the love of God. And so now, because we have the light, the life, and the love, we can begin to study the Word of God. And the revelation is now available to us. The suke begins to be restored. Renewed. have a metamorphosis. But it had to start with a new birth. You had to be born again first. You can't study the scriptures and achieve a place with God simply because you adopt the principles of Christianity as a way of life. Well, repent means to, you know, have a change of mind. Yeah, Jesus didn't say repent. He said be born again. Yeah, you have to have a change of how you live and how you conduct yourself. Jesus said you got to be born again. Yeah, he didn't say he could be, should be. He didn't give you the shoulda, coulda, wouldas. He said you must be born again. Okay? But now that you are, see, when Adam died instantly, spiritually speaking, he eventually died physically, but in the process, his soul was degraded. Now, you get born again. You're now, the life of God comes back, the light comes back, and your soul becomes progressively restored or renewed as you feed on the Word of God. There is an eventual, let's look at Ephesians chapter 1. And I can give you other scriptures on these, but we're, you know, I feel like we could stay here 6 months. What was I looking for? Okay. Ephesians 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 12. That we should be to the... So here we're going to get down here to the body. Ephesians 1, 12, 14. Okay? What does it say? It says that we should be the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and whom also you, after you believed, you received the Holy Spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance unto the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his glory. What's he talking about here? He's talking about the body. So your spirit got born again instantly. The Bible teaches us to renew our mind. There is the redemption of the purchased possession. You get your body back. But you're going to get it back according to the word of God. Over in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Let's look over there. 1 Thessalonians 4. We'll start in verse 14. I think it's 17 about. I'll change it if I find we're different or we read further. Okay? Actually, I would not have you ignorant concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, well, if you're a believer, you have to believe he died and rose again. Why? Because Paul wrote and said that you have to believe in your heart he's been raised from the dead. Over in Romans chapter 10. Okay? To be saved. All right? If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord. Now Paul makes this emphatic. I'm speaking by unction of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. That we which are alive and remain at the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. Now that's King Jimmy for, we're not going to get up before they do. Okay? We're not taking off before they get up. We won't prevent them. We won't go ahead of them. All right? For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. In other words, they're going to get up, and as they come by on the way up out of the ground with their bodies, then we go up. We're not going ahead of them. We're not going to get a head start. If you're alive when Christ comes back, you don't get a head start. You got to wait. All right? Just a millisecond. All right? Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Hallelujah. Can you say glory, glory, glory?
Glory.
Hallelujah. Amen. You know? And then another passage of scripture, and I'm trying to think of where it is right off, that this corruption shall put on incorruption, this mortal shall put on immortality, and the moment in the twinkling of an eye will be changed. Hallelujah. We got a 1 Corinthians 15. Can I get another direct scripture? Can I get another scripture? 1 Corinthians 15. So we'll add to this. 1 Corinthians 15. Is it 52 where it starts? Okay. And it says here, 51. We got to read 51. These aren't in my notes. That's why I'm having to go different. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. Get some folks talking about going to heaven. They get excited. Hallelujah. You ought to be excited about heaven. Hallelujah. Now, what would 1 Thessalonians say? You know? We won't prevent them which are asleep. Y'all here, you go home. But we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trump shall sound, the dead in Christ shall be raised incorruptibly, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruptible, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying which is written, death, where is thy death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of the sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 57. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. What's going to happen? The body has a promise. And that's why we teach on healing so much, because the body doesn't get, when you get born again, the body, that you don't, we used to have, there used to be a doctrine that ran around. It ran around the end of the 50s, kind of on the heels of what was called the latter rain move. Okay? And then it became known as the manifested sons of God. They were all going to get our glorified bodies. We're going to walk around, you know, and they're going to come take all the people who don't get that revelation out of the planet. I mean, you're talking about New Age stuff. The mothership going to come get everybody. I mean, crazy stuff. You know, the manifested sons of God. No. The Bible clearly tells us when that happens. As a matter of fact, 1 John states it this way. I believe 1 John, oh, where are you? Where? Come on now. When he shall appear, we shall be as he is, for we'll see him as he is. That's right. Come on, get those concordances out and go for it, guys. Come on.
4:17.
Thank you. No, that's because he has, he is, so we in this world. But the Bible teaches us that when he appears, we shall be as he is, because we see him as he is. Okay? So that body doesn't get changed. But God didn't leave our bodies to be corrupted the whole time we were here. By his stripes we were healed. We can live our days in health and wholeness and soundness. Okay? So what happens at the new birth, we begin the reversal of Satan's overtaking of humanity. Number one, the spirit gets born again. Number two, the soul gets progressively redeemed. And in the body has a promise of an eventual redemption where man is now not death doomed. He's not mortal. Corruption has put on incorruption. Immortality has put on immortality. Thank you. That's what I was looking for. 1 John 3:2. Okay? We'll have to get out of here. 1 John 3:2. Thank you. Beloved, Now are we the sons of God. What's happened? Our spirits have been born again. We're full of God. We're born of God. We're the sons of God. Glory to God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be. Why? Because the body hadn't been transformed. All right. But we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. See, when he comes to get the church is when the body gets transformed. When he comes to get the church, that's when the bodies raise up out of the ground. When he comes to get the church, corruption shall put on incorruption, mortals shall put on immortality. We change in the moment, in the twinkling of an eye. We'll raise up and be so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
So, the new birth begins the process of restoring man back to his fullness. Let me say something here. Now remember, the disciples came to Jesus, and the mother of James and John wanted them to sit one on his right hand, one on his left hand in the kingdom, because there's going to be ruling. And one of the things that John tells us is, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. Now the blood of Jesus has cleansed where Satan tainted, but God's going to wipe it away and bring a new heaven and a new earth. And in that place, man will have the full restoration of spirit, soul, and body to live in the way God originally intended.
I'm ready.
What?
I'm ready.
You're ready. My preacher said one time, he said, who wants to go to heaven? Everybody raised their hand, set this little boy in the front row. He said, son, don't you want to go to heaven? Yes, Pastor, I want to go to heaven. Why didn't you raise your hand? He said, I thought you were getting up a load to go right now. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. So, we now have. So we can say this, man's spirit is born again instantly. His soul is renewed or restored progressively. And his body has current benefits with a future glorification. Okay, the body gets current benefits. In other words, health and healing and wholeness. But a future glorification. The spirit got born again right away. He became alive unto God. You may not have felt like it, but you were. And then the soul, over time, through the word of God, becomes restored, restored, saved. And your body has a promise. You ain't going to have that thing when you get to heaven. Hello? You ain't going to be overweight in heaven. You ain't going to be sick. There ain't no scratchers or crutches there. Have you got any kind of scriptural allegory for that? Yeah. Have you ever read I believe, Psalm 119, 135? That when he brought them out, there was not one feeble one among their tribes. Now, how many of you have ever seen Cecil B. DeMille or Cecil B. DeMille's, however you want to pronounce it, but Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments. Not the silent version, the 1950s version. I don't know if you know this, he made a 1920s version that was silent, black and white. When they were filming the new version, they found props in the desert of, you know, the lynxes and stuff that they had used in the original version. Hallelujah. But it was a silent film. You know, they got the guys coming out and stretching, the blind guy, you know, and all that. Ain't what happened. They came out of Egypt. They came into the promised land whole. We get heaven whole. But you don't have to suffer all down here. You can get the future, the benefits of being healed and whole now. But in heaven, you're not going to have an overweight body, an underweight body. You're not going to be cross-eyed. You're not going to be bow-legged. My wife says, she looks at me and says, you bow-legged rascal. She's been saying that since we dated. Now that I've lost weight, got skinny, she really says, boy, you. Thank you, honey. Makes you want to wear shorts next time. Huh? Yeah, I lost weight. You don't think I've lost weight? Since last year, about this time, about 45 pounds. Yeah.
Everybody give Pastor a hand
clap. All right. So, you got all this? Because we got to quit. I'm running late. You got this? Somebody take pictures of it. Let's receive our offering. We're going to go home. Before that, we're going to pray for this prayer cloth. Father, we pray over this prayer cloth. We thank you that the Word of God's accurate. The Word of God's true. We thank you that his hands are laid on this cloth. It will be taken from here. It will be laid on those who are infirm. And we thank you that the evil spirits go. Their bodies are rid of the diseases. And they're made every whit whole from the top of their head to the soles of their feet. We speak your healing anointing over this now. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Amen.
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.